Though the nations rage, kingdoms rise and fall, there is still one King reigning over all. So I will not fear, for this truth remains that my God is the Ancient of Days. None above Him, none before Him, all of time in His hands. For His throne it shall remain and ever stand. All the power, for my God is the Ancient of Days. Though the dread of night overwhelms my soul, He is with me. I am not alone, for His name, what the future brings. I will watch and wait for the Savior King. Then my joy complete, standing face to face in the presence of the Ancient of Days. His throne it shall remain and never stand. All the power, all the glory, I will trust in His name. For my God is the Ancient of Days. For my God is the Ancient of Days.
My dwelling place is God Most High, my refuge and my fortress. When plague and pestilence draw nigh, I'm hidden in His presence. When terrors fall and arrows fly, His shield will be my safety. When stones across my path pathway lie. On angels' wings I'm carried. My dwelling place is God Most High, a present help in danger. I rest secure in love's pure light, beneath my master's favor. He freed me from the fowler's snare, pure sin and shame had bound me. Deceive, I'd made my refuge there, till fearless he came for me. Wonderful, powerful, my hope and my defender, mighty God, Emmanuel, my dwelling place forever. I'll never seek another, for I am his and he is mine. My heart he'll keep forever. I know the name on whom I call, he promises to answer. With life he satisfies my soul and crowns me with his pleasure. Wonderful, powerful, my hope and my defender, mighty God, Emmanuel, my dwelling place forever. Wonderful, powerful, my hope and my defender, mighty God, Emmanuel, my dwelling place forever. My dwelling place forever.
Good morning, church. Isaiah 25 verse 1 says, Lord, you are my God. I will exalt you and praise your name, for in perfect faithfulness you have done wonderful things, things planned long ago. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we praise you because you are truly faithful to us. Praise your holy name. Father, we thank you so much for the life you gave us. Thank you for the provision of food that you provide daily in our table. Thank you for our works, the jobs we have, so we could provide for our needs and our family. Thank you for sustaining us and seeing us through the pandemic, which is almost a year now. Father, we pray that you continue to give us strength and hope as we wait for the cure and the vaccine for the COVID virus. Father, we pray for our government officials that they may know you and fear you, so that they will serve our country according to your plan. Lord, we humbly ask you to keep the administration of corruption, especially in dealing with vaccine and its dissemination to the nation. Also, Father, we pray our students that they not only acquire knowledge as they study online, but also wisdom in their everyday tasks. We pray that the student have stable internet connection And as they gain knowledge and learning, they learn more about you also. We lift up to you, Father, our church ministry, the Gacha Good Group, that they may know you more and grow closer to you, that you use their ates and kuya to be the channel of your plan for them. We pray that you give wisdom and knowledge to the mentors and strengthen their faith in you. Father, bless our Sunday school, strengthen our teachers, and give them the knowledge and wisdom on how to impart to the children your love and grace. We lift up to you our growth groups. Let be the channel of strength and guide each member and believers to know you more and be faithful to your commandments. Father, we pray for our church leader, our elder, and deacons, that you lead them and bless them with wisdom as they lead your people to you and be a good steward of the church. We pray, Father, for our pastor, PRB, for his health, that you continue to heal him and give him the strength to deliver your message. Strengthen his immune system, protect him from all sicknesses, anxieties, and weariness. Also for our beloved teacher, Pam, as she continues to serve you, Lord, with PRB as his partner in life and in ministry. Most of all, we pray for all believers, especially the non-believers, that they may feel your presence not only in this worship, but in their daily lives. Father, as we worship today, clean our hearts and mind, remove all distraction in our surrounding, in our minds, and help us focus on your word. As PRB, deliver your message to us. Let the Holy Spirit control everything, Father God. We ask this in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
The scripture reading for today is in Genesis chapter 41, verses 37 to 57. This proposal pleased Pharaoh and all his servants. And Pharaoh said to his servants, "Can we find a man like this, in whom is the Spirit of God?" Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Since God has shown you all this, there is none so discerning and wise as you are. You shall be over my house, and all my people shall order themselves as you command. Only as regards the throne will I be greater than you." And Pharaoh said to Joseph, "See, I have set you over all the land of Egypt." Then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his hand and put it on Joseph's hand, and clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain about his neck. And he made him ride in his second chariot. And they called out before him, "Bow the knee." Thus he set him over all the land of Egypt. Moreover, Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I am Pharaoh, and without your consent, no one shall lift up hand or foot in all the land of Egypt." And Pharaoh called Joseph's name Zaphenath-Phaneah, and he gave him in marriage Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On. So Joseph went out over the land of Egypt. Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh and went through all the land of Egypt. During the 7 plentiful years, the earth produced abundantly, and he gathered up all the food of these 7 years, which occurred in the land of Egypt, and put the food in the cities. He put in every city the food from the fields around it. And Joseph stored up grain in great abundance, like the sand of the sea, until he ceased to measure it, for it could not be measured. Before the year of famine came, 2 sons were born to Joseph. Asenath, the daughter of Potipharah, priest of On, bore them to him. Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh, for he said, God has made me forget all my hardship and all my father's house. The name of the second he called Ephraim, for God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. The 7 years of plenty that occurred in the land of Egypt came to an end, and the 7 years of famine began to come, as Joseph had said. There was famine in all lands, but in all the land of Egypt there was bread. When all the land of Egypt was famished, the people cried to Pharaoh for bread. Pharaoh said to all the Egyptians, "Go to Joseph. What he says to you, do." So when the famine had spread over all the land, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe in the land of Egypt. Moreover, all the earth came to Egypt to Joseph to buy grain, because the famine was severe over all the earth. May the Lord bless the reading of his word.
Hello, good morning everyone. Welcome to our online worship service here at GCF Makati. If this is your first time to be joining us for worship, my name is Rolovic, and on behalf of our whole church family, I just want to welcome you to our church. Welcome to GCF Makati. It is our hope and prayer that you would find our church to be your spiritual home as well. Thank you to everyone who had participated in our time of worship today. Thank you, Munira, for leading us in a time of worship. God bless you and God bless Neil and your whole family. We miss you so much, but we're so happy that we can worship together through this platform. Thank you also to Kuya Robert and to PD for praying and for reading scripture, respectively. Maraming salamat sa partnership nyo and in your life and your faithful witness to the Lord Jesus Christ. We're so happy that we could worship today. Before we get into the word, I just want to give out a quick announcement. Next Sunday, mark your calendars. Next Sunday, we will be having our baptism and right hand of fellowship. You know, this is one of the things that we look forward to as a church, and we're really something that really energizes us and encourages us even in this time of pandemic, that the Lord are adding people to our family, and specifically coming out and testifying about what the Lord has done in their life, in saving them and in causing them to be born again through the waters of baptism. So we're gonna be having that next Sunday. Please mark your calendars. Next Sunday, we will be having that at 2 p.m. Alongside our prayer time, we're gonna be praying for our new members, and we're gonna be witnessing the baptism together. So please mark that. Next Sunday, we are gonna be having baptism and right hand of fellowship. That is next Sunday, February 21, 2021. 21-21. So please mark your calendars. We're going to be having baptism and right hand of fellowship next Sunday. Why don't we join our hearts in prayer? Father, we just thank you for our time together this morning. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity to study your word and just to be together as a family. Would you sanctify this moment? O Holy Spirit, you are our pastor, our leader, and our guide. We submit to you our minds, our affections, and our wills. Take them captive. Lead us to Jesus, Lord. Speak your word to us, Lord. And if there's anyone here listening to this message, Lord, who are hurting, experiencing trauma in their lives, Lord, I pray that this would be of help to them, and then you would help us, Lord, to get back on the road to recovery. So we commit to you this time. Have your way in us, Lord Jesus. We want to commune with you, and we want to glorify you, and we just praise you and we adore you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Today is a very special day because this is one of the times that we can worship during Valentine's Day. So I wonder what your plans are today, if you are married or if you are in a relationship. Definitely celebrations during this time has been a little bit harder to navigate. So today is Valentine's Day. Happy Valentine's Day to you all. I know that this is a happy moment for many, but also for some that this could also be a time of loneliness and sadness. Specifically, you know, if you are away from your partner right now because of the pandemic, siguro you're experiencing long distance relationship of some sorts and you're celebrating Valentine's through Zoom, or maybe a little bit harder that this pandemic has caused friction in your relationship at home, and maybe it's harder for you as a married couple to find common ground, or maybe you are alone right now and you've experienced past traumas in your life, and this is just a lonely time for you today. I didn't plan this out, but today our message falls on a portion in Joseph's life where we can learn some principles about moving through trauma. Moving through trauma, and I intentionally phrased it that way, and I was debating whether to say moving on from trauma or moving through trauma, and I think na maybe moving through trauma is a better way to say it, because we don't really move on for something from something. No? The things that happen to us stay with us, and whether good or bad, the things that happen to us add to our life, no? Either make us better people or make us bitter people. And so I would like to talk about today, how do we move through trauma, move through it, knowing that we these realities are part of our lives now, but instead of making us bitter people, that we would be better people because of it. I looked up the definition of trauma, and I found this from a website called integratedlistening.com. What is trauma? And the site says, trauma is the response to a deeply distressing or disturbing event that overwhelms an individual's ability to cope, causes feelings of helplessness, diminishes their sense of self, and their ability to feel a full range of emotions and experiences. So it's a response to a deeply distressing or disturbing event, no? And the cause and the output of it, it overwhelms us, no? We can't cope, feelings of helplessness, a sense of self, and ability to feel a range of emotions and experiences. It makes us numb, it makes us frightened, lonely sometimes. So look at these words that are highlighted in this definition. Are these words true in your life right now? Are you feeling a deep sense of distress or being disturbed, or feeling overwhelmed right now? How's your ability to cope? No, are you resilient still, or are you a little bit emotionally fatigued? Do you feel helpless? How's your sense of self and self-worth? And are you able to feel a full range of emotions and experiences? Meaning to say, can you feel happy? Are you able to feel happy? Are you able to feel rested, sad, angry? Can you experience this multiple range of emotions? Because if some or a lot of this are true about you, you might be experiencing the effects of a certain trauma in your life. And I hope that if we just come clean before the Lord, you know, there's nobody really, there's not a lot of people around us right now because of this pandemic. And I just hope that you would contemplate in your heart, you know, have you experienced a certain trauma in your life that is running your life right now, influencing your life, or ruining your life at this moment? Because if you do, the scripture for us today says that we can move through trauma by the grace of the Lord. No, the website continues on to say that there are certain responses and symptoms of trauma. These are responses to a traumatic event. Response to a traumatic event varies significantly among people, but there are some basic common symptoms. And just want to share to you some. So emotional signs include sadness, anger, maybe denial, fear, and shame. These might lead to some nightmares, insomnia, inability to sleep, difficulty with relationships, emotional outbursts. Common physical symptoms, meron din pala, no? Nausea, dizziness, altered sleep patterns, changes in appetite, headaches, gastrointestinal problems. There are also psychological disorders that may include PTSD or post-traumatic stress disorder, depression, anxiety, dissociative disorder, substance abuse problems. Just look at this list, and I don't know, if you have experienced trauma, I just want you to know that the Bible says, it encourages us that we can move through it. We can move through trauma by the grace of the Lord. No, I discovered this person as I was doing some studying this week, and this is a person who experienced a profound trauma in his life. His name is Elie Wiesel. Elie Wiesel is a Holocaust survivor. He has been imprisoned during the Nazi time. He's a Jew, no? In the Auschwitz and Buchenwald concentration camps, no? And he experienced a tremendous trauma in his life. If you look at this picture, he's the one right there, no? Where you would see the highlighted circle. That's him in the Buchenwald concentration camp. You know, Elie Wiesel come from a very religious family. His mother taught him about the faith. In fact, you can trace his origins and genealogy to profound rabbis, no, very well-known rabbis. But during his time in imprisonment, he reflected on what was going on in his life, and in one of his well-known poems, no, he said these words: "Never shall I forget that night, the first night in camp, which has turned my life into one long night, seven times cursed and seven times sealed. Never shall I forget that smoke. Never shall I forget the little faces of the children whose bodies I saw turned into wreaths of smoke beneath a silent blue sky. Never shall I forget those flames which consumed my faith forever. Never shall I forget that nocturnal silence which deprived me for all eternity of the desire to live. Never shall I forget those moments which murdered my God and my soul and turned my dreams to dust. Never shall I forget these things, even if I am condemned to live as long as God Himself. Never." Elie Wiesel, who can blame him for feeling these emotions, these profound emotions, having gone through the crises and the trauma of a concentration camp? He was deprived of his humanity. He was tortured, no? Not only physically, psychologically, emotionally, in all kinds of ways. He was profoundly tortured. And out of that comes this profound bitterness in his soul. Never will I forget. No, that's the word that he constantly says. And it's striking to me. No, sabi niya, never shall I forget those moments which murdered my God and turned my dreams to dust. He used to be a very idealistic person, believed in goodness, believed in God, but because of this tremendous suffering, no, sabi niya, yun yung way niya sabihin na he has lost hope, he has lost faith in God, the crisis has murdered his God. Have you experienced trauma just like this? Have you experienced being harassed, maybe bullied, sexually abused, abandoned, neglected, slandered? Have you lost your property because of natural calamity? Have you experienced a certain form of trauma in your life that makes it hard for you to cope with life as we know it? In my research, I found out that there are three kinds of trauma. There's acute trauma, where this results from a single stressful or dangerous event. Now, for example, if you experience a calamity like a typhoon, very bad typhoon or earthquake, is a one-time thing. It's an acute trauma. There's a chronic trauma as well. This results from repeated and prolonged exposure to highly stressful events. Examples include cases of child abuse, bullying, or domestic violence. And there's this third kind of trauma. It's complex trauma. This results from exposure to multiple traumatic events. No? So, you know, have you experienced any of this? Elie Wiesel obviously have experienced a complex kind of trauma and a chronic kind of trauma. He lived through the concentration camps. But let me just tell you, there's another person in the Bible who really experienced, you know, trauma in all of its acuteness, all of its chronicness and complexity. And that's Joseph. Look at Joseph's trauma, no? Joseph lived through childhood bullying. His brothers bullied him to death, literally. Physical harassment. He was thrown into a pit. He was sold to slavery, no? He was sexually assaulted by Mrs. Potiphar. He was slandered and defamed, and he lost everything that he has built and everything that he put together for himself out of this slavery. He was falsely imprisoned, and he was socially abandoned by these friends that he had helped out. No, Joseph, you know, lived through complex trauma, chronic trauma, acute trauma, all kinds of trauma was so present in his life. And if you think about it, these things, if it happened, if one or two of these things happened to a person, that would be enough for a person to be really depressed, anxious, have post-traumatic stress disorder. Now, even suicidal. But there's something in Joseph's life, no, that makes him buoyant, that makes him able to go through these hard things, very hard things. I mean, isa lang dito, even just one of these things would be enough for a person to be scarred for life. But he was able not just to move on from trauma, because we would find in our study as we go along that these trauma sticks with him, no? But he had moved through it, no? Through it. He did not escape it, but he went under it and through it and out of it, he became a better person, not a bitter person. So when you go through trauma, there are two results that can happen to you. You can be like Elie Wiesel, where because of the trauma, he became really bitter and lost hope. Or you can be like Joseph, and you can thrive by the grace of the Lord. No, and look at this. And our meditation today, our study today, would focus on this passage. This is the key passage, really, to understand how Joseph had moved through traumas in his life. That's Genesis 41, verses 50 to 52. Again, Genesis 41, 50 to 52. And I hope you have your Bibles with you so that you can underline and mark your Bibles in circle or highlight together with me. No, Genesis 41, 50 to 52 says, "So before the year of famine came, two sons were born to Joseph. Asenath, the daughter of Potiphar, priest of On, bore them to him. So Joseph called the name of the firstborn Manasseh. For he said, 'God has made me forget all my hardship and all my father's house.' The name of the second he called Ephraim. 'For God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction.'" So these two children that had been born to Joseph marked his remembrance of how the Lord had seen him through this season of trauma. The first one was Manasseh, and Manasseh, to have Manasseh is to be able to forget, no, to not remember the sting of a certain event. He says, "God has made me forget all my hardship and all of my father's house. God had made me forget all of these things." The name Ephraim, it means to be fruitful, no? God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. Our study today would focus on these things, and we can glean principles how to get over, you know, how to move through trauma. But I just want you to know the repeated sense here that Joseph is highlighting. God has made me forget. God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. The operating words here in the heart of the principle on how Joseph got through his trauma is by the grace of God. God has made me forget. God has made me fruitful. We can move through trauma only by the grace of God. The way to move through traumas, our trauma, is by leaning on God's grace that overpowers all our hardships, bad experiences, and pain, and makes us fruitful in the land of our affliction. We can grow by the grace of the Lord in seasons of calamity and distress. We can be fruitful despite our trauma. Now, you would think na siguro this trauma is stagnating me. But in reality, even in that situation, in that bitter situation of our lives, the Lord can cause growth and fruitfulness to come upon us, and the Lord can take away not the memory, but the sting of the memory, the remembrance of it from our lives so that we can be better people. I know it's easier said than done. I know it's ill easy to say for us to live by the grace of God. But when we are in the thick of trauma, when we are in the thick of crises, of depression, and of anxiety, we want to will ourselves to lean on the grace of God. But in practicality, it's hard to do that. I have to admit, no? This past few weeks, I've not been feeling well. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord for your prayers. I'm starting to be well now. The past week has been so much better than the previous weeks. Medications are kicking in, and I'm getting a lot better. So don't worry about me. I just want to say to you that I thank the Lord for allowing me to go through this month of difficulty with my physical body. Just to say that, you know, sometimes when you're going through something that hurts, all you can think about is the thing that's hurting you. No, and I have to confess, when you know I have discomfort in my stomach, it's so hard to study the Bible. It's so hard to be nice, even to my wife. It's so hard to take hold of my emotions. It's so hard to focus on any other thing, because all you can think about is the discomfort that you're feeling. Now, I'm just talking about dyspepsia, indigestion. No, a bad case of indigestion. But think about it. If you're experiencing something like Joseph had experienced, like Elie Wiesel had experienced, it's multiplied to the 10th degree or the 100,000th degree, where that's the only thing you can think about. How can I manage? How can I move on? How can I move through these things? And I'm here to tell you, we can lean on the grace of God in very practical ways. And I just want to share to you some principles how we can do this in a very practical way as well, no? The first principle I just want to share to you is that we have to let God work freely in our lives. Let God work freely in your life. Freely is the operating word here, because sometimes the Lord is working in our lives, but it is our tendency to resist the Lord's work, no? Let me show you this passage. Genesis 41, 37 to 40 says, no, Joseph is standing before Pharaoh at this point and giving him advice about what to do concerning his dream. No, 7 years of plenty and 7 years of famine. Genesis 41, 37 to 40 says, this proposal pleased Pharaoh and all his servants. And Pharaoh said to his servants, can we find a man like this in whom is the Spirit of God? Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, since God has shown you all this, there is none so discerning and wise as you are. You shall be over my house, and all my people shall order themselves as you command. Only as regards to the throne will I be greater than you. Now, if you are joining the story just at this point, you would probably have the impression that Joseph was an overnight success. Surely, if you are one of the servants of Pharaoh at his court at that point, no, you'd probably think that. And rightfully so, because 30 minutes ago, or an hour or 30 minutes ago, Joseph was a prisoner, right, in Pharaoh's prison. And he was a steward in that prison, but he was a prisoner nonetheless. And then just at a certain point, Pharaoh dreamed a dream. He was taken out of prison. He had a good shave. He changed his clothes and gave Pharaoh advice. And now Pharaoh recognizes that he is a discerning man, and he makes him the prime minister of Egypt. So for all intents and purposes, if you just jump into the story at this point, it's easy to say that Joseph was an overnight success, no? That for some reason he was at the right place at the right time, and he was lucky, and he became prime minister just because of that. But what you don't realize if you just jump into the story at this point, that there is a certain process that Joseph had to go through in order for him to be prepared for this situation in his life. There is a 13-year process that the Lord allowed him to go through, no, for him to be prepared for that moment that he will be standing before Pharaoh. And if Joseph, no, if Joseph did not allow the Lord to work freely in his life during the time of favor from Jacob, time of being thrown into the pit, time of being a steward in Potiphar's house, and time of being slandered and falsely imprisoned, if he didn't allow the Lord to work freely in his life, no, at that point, if he resisted, if he gave up and said, you know what, I have lost faith, these circumstances, these experiences, in the words of Elie Wiesel, have murdered my God. God has forsaken me. There's no point in doing this anymore. I give up. I'm just going to be in prison. And then he would not be ready for that moment, no? That moment where he would stand before Pharaoh. There are seasons in our lives and there are moments in our lives. And it is in those seasons that the Lord had allowed us to go through prolonged seasons of trials and testing, even suffering and trauma, that the Lord molds us and prepares us for that moment, that open door that he is granting us to walk into. You know, the Lord has planned open doors for us, but some of the doors he had planned for us, he means for us to push that door open as well. We push that door open by allowing the Lord to work freely in our lives, cooperating with him in the process of being molded to be the kind of person that glorifies him. Paul says in Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 and 13, he says, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Why? For it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure." Work out your salvation. The Lord had already saved you. The Lord has a plan for your life. But it is incumbent for us to work this out. And not work for it, no, but work this out. The only way you can work out something is if you have it. You have this presence of the Lord in your life. He is with you. But learn to work it out. Not only in the seasons of good and plenty, but in the seasons of trauma and distress as well. Because you know what? If you endure patiently, I believe one day, you too can be an overnight success. Isn't that ironic? If you endure patiently, you know what? One day, you'll be an overnight success as well. So that's the first principle here. Let God work freely in your life. The second one is a little bit like it, but a little bit more precise. Allow the Lord to work freely, no, in your life. Meaning to say, hayaan niyo siya na siya yung boss, no, be sovereign over your life. But also, let God transform you. Let God transform you. What I want to say is we should stop trying to transform ourselves. God is the potter. We are the clay. Let him have his way. Because one of the things we often do when we experience trauma, the best way that we can think of to get over our traumas is to have a new persona. It could range from anywhere between changing your profile picture on social media to having a good haircut or a new wardrobe or new social circle, retail therapy, because we want to transform ourselves, right? We want to have a better presentation of ourselves. You know, that's okay. I'm not condemning that. But what I'm trying to say is we should let God do the transforming for us. Now, sometimes when you're going through calamity and crisis and trauma, well, it's easy to be envious of other people. Maybe if I look like this person, if I have this person as a peg for my life, no, peg natin to, maybe I could thrive a little bit better. But why don't we allow God to define what kind of person we ought to be? And why don't we allow Jesus to be the peg of our life, that we could be transformed into his image? Joseph was really transformed. He was really transformed. Look at this passage, Genesis 41, 41 to 45. Let me just read it to you. It says, "And Pharaoh said to Joseph, 'See, I have set you over all the land of Egypt. Then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his hand and put it on Joseph's hand and clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain about his neck. And he made him ride in his second chariot, and they called out before him, "Bow the knee." Thus he set him over all the land of Egypt. Moreover, Pharaoh said to Joseph, "I am Pharaoh, and without your consent, no one shall lift up hand or foot in all the land of Egypt." And Pharaoh called Joseph's name Zaphnath-Paneah, and he gave him in marriage to Asenath, a daughter of Potiphar, a priest of On. So Joseph went out over the land of Egypt. Joseph was really transformed. Let me just show you some of the ways he was transformed. Number one, he was given territorial authority. In verse 41, Pharaoh says, "See, I have set you over all the land of Egypt." Over all the land of Egypt. He became prime minister. He had territorial authority. Secondly, he had financial authority. Then Pharaoh took his signet ring from his hand and put it on Joseph's hand and clothed him in garments of fine linen and put a gold chain about his neck. And he made him ride in his second chariot. I just want to point out, no, this is very similar to what had happened to Joseph's brother Judah. Remember when he had an affair, this bad relationship with Tamar? He left his signet ring, his staff, and his chain. No, he gave that up to have sexual immorality. But Joseph, on the other hand, he received these things as a promotion from the Lord. He got a signet ring. You know what the signet ring is? It bears the stamp of authority. It's like Pharaoh giving Joseph his credit card, right? A credit card or his signature, that whatever Joseph signs, whatever check he signs, it would cash. Whatever letter he writes, it would have authority. It is great financial authority. Not only the power of the ring, but the vestments. Now, he is clothed in fine linen. It's amazing that as Joseph, no, remains faithful to the Lord, though, no, two things happen to him. His garments are taken away from him, as in the case of when his multicolored robe was taken away from him. But it becomes replaced as well as when Potiphar gave him authority over his house. When Mrs. Potiphar slandered him, she took his garments. But the garments had been changed to fine linen now. And this is a picture of restoration from the Lord. Put a gold chain about his neck. And look at this. He even got the company car. No? He even got the company car. He made him ride in his second chariot. Meaning to say, Joseph is really financially okay. From being prisoner to this financial independence, it's quite remarkable. And thirdly, he had public authority, because whenever Joseph would go out, it says here in 43b, you know, and they called out before him, "Bow the knee." So there are people who are just calling out as Joseph rides into town, "Bow the knee." And it says here, "Thus he set him over the land of Egypt. Moreover, said to Joseph, 'I am Pharaoh, and without your consent, no one shall lift up hand or foot in the land of Egypt.'" He had great public authority. People were now under him. Pharaoh called his name Zaphnath-Paneah. He had a new name. He's a different person now. But I just want you to note that all of these things, what we can see here is Pharaoh was the one who is giving him this authority, these vestments. But what we don't see underneath all of this is that in reality, it is God. It is God who had allowed Joseph to go through the process of metamorphosis, of being changed. You know, whenever we talk about metamorphosis, we remember butterflies. I took these pictures from my mom's social media, you know. We know that butterflies comes from caterpillar, no? That caterpillars turn into butterflies. But what we normally forget is that there's this process where the caterpillar becomes a chrysalis. No? Misnomer pala yung goes into a cocoon, no? But it's called a chrysalis. No? And inside of that chrysalis, you know what happens to the caterpillar? The caterpillar literally dies. All of his internal parts dissolves, no? Inside of this cocoon, this chrysalis, no? This outer covering, inside of that, the caterpillar dies. And out of that death, you know, certain hormones are triggered, and that hormones recreates this caterpillar from the destruction of its former self into something beautiful, into a to a wonderful monarch butterfly. And you know what? That's the same case in our life. When we let the Lord transform us, there's this process of dying that must take place. Diba Jesus says, if you want to be my disciples, take up your cross and follow me. There's this dying to yourself. And that's the process of transformation. God takes what you were, deconstructs that, and remolds it to something better. Paul himself testified to that. Galatians 2:20 says, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I have been crucified with Christ. It's not I who live now. I'm a different person. Christ is the one living in me. So the life I'm living now, I'm living by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. He also says, 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. What this means is whenever you see a butterfly, you don't say, what a wonderful caterpillar. That's not a caterpillar anymore. That's a butterfly. It has been transformed. The same thing is true with us. If we allow the Lord to transform us, we die to ourselves. Although there are certain parts of our lives that looks like our previous self, that old self has died. We are now transformed, right? Into the image of Christ. He gives us a new identity. We are now children of God, sons of daughters of God. We are reconciled to God. And the trauma, although it has happened to us, it no longer defines us, because what defines us is the love of Christ, the transformation that comes from God. So let God transform your life. And thirdly, let God determine your life. Let God determine your life. You know, when I was in VBS, College of Bible, I have a professor, the former president of VBS College of Bible, Dr. Ed Banzuelo. And whenever we start our class, he always reminds us, church history class, he always reminds us, there is a prepared place for a prepared person. There is a prepared place for a prepared person. So let God determine your life. Let God prepare you for the plans that he has for you. You know, he has a wonderful plan for you, but if you enter into that plan as you are right now, you can't handle it. You need training. No, because God's plan is wonderful and it's marvelous, and you got to be the person that can handle it. And that involves training. There's a prepared place for a prepared person. It says this in Genesis 41, starting from 41 to 45. Joseph was 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh, king of Egypt. And Joseph went out from the presence of Pharaoh, went through all the land of Egypt. During the 7 plentiful years, the earth produced abundantly, and he gathered up all the food of these 7 years, which occurred in the land of Egypt, and put the food in the cities. He put in every city the food from the fields around it. And Joseph stored up grain in great abundance like the sand of the sea until, look at this, he ceased to measure it, for it cannot be measured. Now let me jump to verse 53. It says, the 7 years of plenty that occurred in the land of Egypt came to an end, and the 7 years of famine began to come. As Joseph had said, there was famine in all lands, but in all the land of Egypt there was bread. When all the land of Egypt was famished, the people cried to Pharaoh for bread. Pharaoh said to all Egyptians, go to Joseph. What he says, you do. Let God determine your life. Joseph was taken away from his father's house when he was around 17 years old, and now he is 30 years old when he entered the service of Pharaoh. That gives us 13 years of suffering for Joseph. 13 years. Have you ever suffered for that length of time? Would you say 13 years is a short time or a long time? I bet all of you are saying it's a long time to suffer. And the magnitude of Joseph's suffering during that course of time was really intense. Everything ranging from bullying to being sold into slavery, into imprisonment, and sexual abuse. All of that encapsulated with a 13-year time frame. And mind you, this is his formative years. This is his teenage years and 20s that Joseph had lived through all of these things. Joseph was 30 years old when he enters Pharaoh's service. Right? And so And so let me just say, we have to let God determine our life. Sometimes we look back and think, you know, that's not how I want to spend my teenage year. That's not what how I want to spend my 20s, no? Normally, during that age, we're being really silly and really carefree, and we do stupid things at that point. No, but Joseph was getting a great education from the Lord. He entered Pharaoh's service at the age of 30. And if we do the math here, there were 7 years of plenty and 7 years of famine. Now, if you total that together, and during those times, he was already prime minister, how long would that be? 14 years. Now, let me ask you, which one is longer, 13 years or 14 years? 14 years, right? And if we read further on in the story, Joseph went over way past 100 years old. So which one is longer? 13 years of suffering or the 14 years of being utilized in this season of being prime minister of Egypt way to your 100 years birthday? Which one is longer? You see, here's how traumas work. Here's how crises work. At the time you're in it, it feels really long. When you are in tremendous pain, one day feels like a year. And 13 years could have just been 130 years. But the Lord has a plan for Joseph's life. The Lord had determined Joseph's life. In fact, the Bible says the Lord makes everything beautiful in its time. Peter had this exhortation. I shared this to you last Sunday, but let me just share it to you again. 1 Peter 5, 6 to 10 says, "Humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may exalt you, casting all your anxieties on him because he cares for you. Be sober-minded, be watchful. Your adversary, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. Resist him. Firm in your faith, knowing that the same kinds of suffering are being experienced by your brotherhood throughout the world. And after, look at this, after you have suffered a little while, just a little while, the God of all grace, who has called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself, siya mismo, restore, confirm, strengthen, and establish you." Just like Joseph, he was restored, confirmed, strengthened, and established. After you have suffered a little while, there is a proper time. We are in between two moments in our lives, the moment when our suffering begins and the moment that we are restored by the Lord. And in that in between, the Lord is preparing us for what he had granted for us to begin with. He had already determined where we're going to end up. He has already determined where we're going to be starting at. There is a prepared place for a prepared person. So the years that Joseph spent being the headmaster of Potiphar's house, a land of plenty, is a preparation for him to be a steward of all of Egypt in times of prosperity. The time that Joseph spent in prison, tending to a house of suffering, will also be Joseph's preparation for the 7 years of famine that not only befalls Egypt, but the rest of the whole world when the Lord taught him compassion there. That's the same compassion he would use as he ministers to people all around the world, tending to their needs. There's a prepared place for a prepared person, so we have to let the Lord determine our lives. Next is we have to let God remove the sting of our past. Let God remove the sting of our past. Look at what Joseph says. So his firstborn, Genesis 41 verse 51, he called the name of his firstborn Manasseh, for he said, "God has made me forget all my hardship and all my father's house." Let us just meditate for that for a little while. The Lord made me forget all my hardship and all my father's house. Let me read to you a great comment by Dr. Charles Wendell, no, from his book, Joseph, A Man of Integrity and Forgiveness. I think he hit it right on the head. So let me just use his words right now and just read to you what he said. Dr. Swindle says, "The name Manasseh literally means the sting is gone out of the remembrance. The sting is gone out of the remembrance." Let me just pause there. You know, God is a God who does not forget anything, right? He's an omniscient God. But then when he forgives our sins, it doesn't mean he forgets, no, that we did that sin. It means that the sting of that offense is gone. It no longer hurts him. No, it has been let go. And so it does not carry weight in his heart anymore, so much so that he would cause us to be condemned or punished. The sting is gone. The sting is gone out of the remembrance. Sometimes we can, and that's something we have to hope for if we're dealing with trauma, no? That not only that we would forget, is that when we remember what had happened to us, the sting is gone. We're not hurt by it anymore. We are made wise because of it, but the sting is gone. Let me read on what Dr. Swindle says. So the name Manasseh means literally means the sting is gone out of the remembrance. While Joseph still carried the vivid memory of being stripped and flung into a pit by his own brothers, of being sold as a slave, of being imprisoned for his personal purity, of being forgotten for 2 years by someone he helped. There was enough heartache in those memories to destroy a young man, to leave him embittered, without hope, depressed, most likely suicidal. Think about that for a moment. Was it the fancy clothes that removed the sting? The carte blanche? Financial clout? The chariot? No, it was God. He alone has the power to take the sting out of the hurtful past. Designer clothes may give us momentary feeling of well-being, but underneath, the wounded memories still fester. They're still painful to the touch. It is only God who can take away the sting of our past. Won't you let God do that? Won't you let God take away the sting of your past? It only stings if we hold on to it, if that's what's in our heart. But if we surrender it to the Lord, the sting is replaced by His grace. The Bible says, Paul in 1 Corinthians 15:55 to 58 says, "Death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." Look at this. "Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord." Why? "Knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain." Sin has no more mastery over us when we are in Christ Jesus. Not only our sins, but the sins of other people who had caused calamity in our lives. In Jesus Christ, we have victory. We got to surrender that to Jesus so that death, we can say, "Death, where is your sting?" The worst thing that could happen for us is to die. But then if you know that your eternal security is right in the hands of the Lord, you are secured in the hands of the Lord. Yes, the reality of death is there, but the sting is gone. If you have been abused in the past, somebody had taken advantage of you, that's something that cannot be erased. That's happened in your life. But in Christ, the sting can be gone when you remember that you are restored in the Lord, that you are whole in the Lord, that you are well and beautiful in the sight of the Lord. The sting is gone, that you are great and you are worthwhile in the eyes, the only eyes that matter. Have you lost everything because of a certain calamity, financial calamity, because of the pandemic? Have you lost your job, lost your savings, your finances? If you know the Lord can provide and He is Ebenezer, that until now He has helped us, yes, this reality is still present, but the sting is gone. Won't you let God take away the sting? Don't keep the sting in your heart. You know, that great hymn, no? What a friend we have in Jesus says, there's that line that says, "Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. Oh, needless sting we bear." Why? All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. You don't have to carry that sting. It doesn't have to hurt anymore. But we have to let God do His work in us, that He would transform us to take away the sting of our past. He can do it. I know He can do it. Won't you come to the Lord and offer Him the pain and the hurts that you have? Don't let that run and ruin your life. Let God take away the sting of your past. Also, let God use your story and your testimony. This is the last thing. Let God use your story and testimony. Look at what Joseph says. Verse 52, "The name of the second child he called Ephraim, for God has made me fruitful in the land of my affliction." The Lord can, you know, make flowers bloom out of a desert place. Even in this time of calamity, the Lord can make something beautiful in our lives. I know if we just have time, we can share stories of how God has transformed our disposition, our perspective, even through this pandemic season. The Lord can make anything beautiful in His time. The Lord had made me fruitful in the land of my affliction. And you know what? In the fruitfulness that the Lord had caused in Joseph's life, was used to bless other people, because at the end of this story, Genesis 41, 56 and 57 says, "So when the famine has spread over all the land, Joseph opened all the storehouses and sold to the Egyptians, for the famine was severe in the land. Moreover, all the earth came to Egypt, to Joseph, to buy grain, because the famine was severe over all the earth." His blessing, his fruitfulness, became a balm of healing, not only for Egypt, but for the rest of the world. I think about the people that have suffered greatly, you know, in their life. You know. For example, Horatio Spafford, the hymn writer of "It Is Well With My Soul," he lost his whole family, you know, his children, out of a shipwreck. He lost all of his possession in the Great Chicago Fire. And he pens down that line, you know, "When peace like a river attends my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot," Tagalog, kahit anong mangyari, "Thou hast taught me to say," tinuruan mo akong sabihin, it is well with my soul." He says, "The sin, oh the bliss of this glorious thought, kasalanan ko kung iisipin ko lang, my sin not in part but the whole, hindi lang yung isa, pero lahat. It is nailed to the cross and I bear it no more, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul." You know, and out of that suffering in his life, no, losing everything, every possession that he had in the Great Chicago Fire, losing his family in the Great Shipwreck, out of that pain, out of that story of God's miraculous intervention in his life, that can be used by the Lord to bless other people as well. You know what? Whatever it is you're going through right now, there's a certain somebody who needs to hear it right now. Are you going through a time of calamity? Gone through abuse, harassment, lost your job? And did the Lord see you through that circumstances? You know, somebody needs to hear that story right now. Won't you share it? Don't keep your story to yourself. May kwenta ang buhay natin kasi may kwento tayo. May nagsabi sa akin, no? No? May kwenta ang buhay natin dahil may kwento tayo. Our life has meaning because we have a story to tell. And it is the story of the Lord's grace in our lives. We can. My brothers and sisters, it's my firm conviction that we can move through our traumas. We can do it by leaning on God's grace that overpowers all our hardships and make us fruitful in the land of our affliction. We can move through our traumas. Not only move on from it, but move through it. So let God work freely in your life. Let God transform you. Let God determine your life. Let God remove the sting of your past and let God use your story and your testimony. I hope this message encouraged your soul. Are you going through a trauma right now? Give it to Jesus. Not only can you move on, you can move through it. Let's join our hearts in prayer. Father, we just thank you for this time in your word. Thank you, Lord, for your grace. Thank you, Lord, for the assurance that we can move through whatever trauma it is that we have gone through in our lives, only because of your grace. And so, Lord, we lift you up. We glorify you. May you receive all the praise and glory that's due your name, not only in the times of our plenty, but in times of adversity and crises as well. Use our story, Lord, for your glory and honor, to be a healing balm to the people who are around us. We thank you, Lord. We glorify you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you all.
You, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hands. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
of the goodness of God.